Welcome to Rock of Faith. You're about to watch a service of April 20th, Wednesday evening at Pastor Jess Tuthill. You can submit prayer requests and check out our church calendar, all at roffont.com. The link is in the video description below.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see each one here. We say God bless you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Beautiful song. Amen. We're going to be in Romans chapter 8 tonight. Romans chapter 8. We're going to ask our sister Mary Lee if she will ask the blessing on the word tonight, please. And this is God's word. This is what the Bible says. And I'd like you to listen tonight. Feel like it's important for our church. Verse 18. For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly awaits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subject to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into this glorious liberty of the children of God. But we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. Not only that, but we also have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly awaiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the heart knows what is the mind of the Spirit, what the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknow, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. And whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And we're going to stop right there. and spend a few minutes in this passage of Scripture. Now, I didn't write this, so you can't blame me for what I read to you tonight. Now, it says here, "For I consider the sufferings of the present time not worthy to be revealed, to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." And I got to thinking about all the challenges that we have as Christians, and especially in this particular year, we've had lots of people who have been faced with challenges. And as we pray and as we consider what God's will is for us, we realize that we have opposition from the enemy. The enemy, amen, is trying to hinder us from doing what God wants us to do. But the Bible says here that we shouldn't even consider what things that the devil does to us compared to the glory that's going to be revealed in us. That one day, the glory of God is going to be revealed in us. He's going to transform our body like unto His glorious body. And we're going to get to be with Him forever and forever. But one of the things that's significant here is the opposition that the church faces. People face opposition. And so the Bible says when we pray that Jesus knows and the Holy Spirit knows what is the mind of the Spirit. And so God knows exactly what we have need of. I didn't get one amen on that. God knows exactly where you live. He knows your exact circumstances. He knows your situation. And He knows exactly what you need. And as we begin to pray and as we purpose to pray, especially in the Spirit, praying in tongues, we get the mind and will of God. Many years ago, I had a person share with me, and I know what the Scripture says, that we should pray that we have the we should desire the with all wisdom, amen, the perfect will of God for our lives. But because we have such improper instruction, many Christians believe that what the will of God is for our life isn't necessarily what God's will really is for us. In other words, we are anticipating God to do something that He does not have any plans to do for us. And so while we're praying, we are supposed to give thanks for where we are in life and what we're doing, because God said in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And what I'm saying is that you are probably in the will of God right now, and what you need to do is thank the Lord, amen, and through His great mercy, it said, no weapon formed against us will prosper, nothing can separate us from the love of God, and all things work together for good. So that means that no matter where we are in life, God is working that situation together for good, that we can overcome it. We will, through His power and grace, get to the other side. Amen. I'm looking forward to the things that God has for me. And here it is explaining hope. Hope is not something that's negative. But He's explaining that if you can see it, why do you yet hope for it? So when we pray in line with the promises of God, knowing that what God has said is going to come to pass. And though we don't see it tonight, we have hope tonight. Can I get a witness, amen, that what God said He's going to do, I'm hoping tonight because I don't see it. I don't touch it. I can't taste it. Not only is hope working, but faith is working tonight. It's working for me anyway. And that everything is all right. Everything is going to turn out. God is going to do great things on our behalf. He's working all things together for good. He already defeated the principalities and powers. And so He's already set in motion our deliverance. Come on, amen. He's already set in motion what we have need of, amen. These first few months of this year have been quite a challenge for a lot of people I know. And not only myself, but others have spent a lot of time in the hospital. And we have sat waiting for people while they had surgery or other procedures done for them. And while we were there, we had to wait. And sometimes the doctors were late. Sometimes the other people were late. Sometimes they didn't do it on the day they said it would. Sometimes they extended the day. And so what was supposed to take place on Monday didn't take place on Monday. And it may have not taken place on Tuesday. And it may have had to wait until all the way until Wednesday. But it doesn't mean that it wasn't the will of God. I wish I could get a witness tonight. Amen. We don't always get to do what we want to do. But sitting in the hospital praying for somebody doesn't mean we're out of the will of God. And just because the doctor's late or he doesn't show up on that day or he waits to a different day doesn't mean anything. It just means that we've had to wait and be patient. And if you don't understand what God is doing, he's extending your faith another day. Can I get a witness? You were praying and you were thinking today's the day and it wasn't today and you tried tomorrow and it wasn't the next day, but you had to wait a third day and finally God showed up on the third day. Praise God. Hallelujah. God is developing us. Amen. And letting us know that his will is being done in our life and we need to give thanks for where we are tonight. Amen. God is letting us, amen, and we're privileged, amen, to suffer for his sake, to wait, amen, anxiously, so to speak, or have to wait, amen, when we have need of something. And even though we need it today, we may not get it today because God is the one that's in control. And so we wait upon the Lord and we're hoping for that very thing, amen, that we have need of. How many know God is going to do it for you? Amen. You don't know what day he's going to do it on, and we're not going to quit. I'm not quitting, amen, because I don't get something today. I'm going to hope that God will do it tomorrow. If he doesn't do it tomorrow, I'm not going to quit tomorrow. I will still come back and pray and wait on God, and he will do it sooner or later, whether the devil likes it or not. God is going to minister to my need. But it takes a person to be determined. It takes a person to have faith in God so that the will of God will actually be done in your life. Even though you may be challenged tonight, doesn't make a difference. God is going to do the things that are necessary in your life. Amen. I've had too many situations where I've seen, amen, that God is working in my life. I'll just share a couple of them. One day, I was work was just about to be over, and most of the time, we have set our day to where when we finish, we clock out and we head for our cars, and we get in our cars and we go home. Well, this particular day, we ran into some situations that delayed me a few minutes from being able to get over to the clock and punch out and go home right at the quitting time. And the few minutes that I was delayed, there was an accident in front of the school that I worked at. And had I finished on the exact time that I normally finish and gone out to my car, I would have probably been right in the middle of an accident. And so the delay was so wonderful that it spared me from being in an accident. Now, most of us probably complain the whole day we were late, 5 minutes, and we had to wait, and this and that, and the other, and that's not what God is looking for. Do you know that God watches over you night and day? Do you know that the angel of the Lord's encamped about you, amen, to deliver you? And so some of our trials and tests, amen, cause us to be in the will of God, even though we think we're out of the will of God. Can I get just one amen? Some of the things we go through in life, we think, how can this be God's will? And yet, in fact, we are walking in the middle of the will, the perfect will and plan of God in our life. One of these days, we are going to respond to it. Amen. When I'm praying, I've shared it many times that God is listening to what I'm saying. The only thing is he's answering my prayer according to his will for me. Amen. One good example was years ago when I was in between jobs and I would come to church and ask the prayer group to pray for me. They would be praying for me to get a job. And so as they began to pray for me, I would pray something like, oh, God, I'll take anything. Just give me any kind of job. I'll work anywhere. I'll do whatever. And the ladies would tell me, no, we're not praying that prayer. We're going to pray a prayer for you to be in a place where you're supposed to be, where you can fit in and you can do the will of God for your life. Amen. We're not giving you anything. We don't want just anything. We want the will of God for you. Amen. We want you to get plugged in somewhere. I said, no, just pray for anything. I'll take anything. And they said, we're not going to do it. We're going to pray and we're going to ask God for the perfect will of God for your life. And I find myself, even now, that the challenges that I have do not put me out of the will of God. They just let me know that God has a different plan for me. And if I keep praying and keep believing, then God is going to work through me to get his work done. He doesn't check in with me, amen, and ask me what I want to do today. He tells me, this is what you need to do today, and then he works out the details, amen. We've been sharing about having to be at the hospital, and some days we've spent hours and hours there. And normally, amen, that we don't normally have to do that, but because of certain circumstance, we did. But it was the will of God for me to be there. Y'all not listen to me. It was God's plan, God's purpose for me to be there. And often while I'm in the hospital, people ask me questions. People want to know about godly things or scriptures. And so I find myself answering questions and also talking to people I don't normally get to talk to. And no matter what I want to do, I wish I could get a witness. I have a plan. I want to stop at a certain restaurant on my way home. Can I get a witness? I want to go do this today. I'm going to go to the hospital, then I'm going to do this. And God says, no, you're not. You're going to stay there all day, and you're going to talk to this one and this one and this one and this one. And I don't care what you want to do today. You're going to do my will for the plan of God for your life. Because these people need to hear the gospel. I'm preaching to me tonight. Amen. Often I find these things happening. It's not bad, it's good. Amen. Come on. It's not bad, it's good. Praying in tongues has often put me in the will of God, even though I thought I was out of it. Praying in the Spirit has put me in a place being able to witness to somebody or answer someone's question or just spend time with somebody and be able to assist them and help them in their Christian walk. I've had people, amen, that normally don't come to church start asking me questions, and I have been able to answer them. And they've had sometimes aught against God, or they had aught against someone else, and by the time our conversation finished, they realized that wasn't right, and they would forgive the person and or that, or realize that God did not do that to them, and they let it go because it wasn't what God actually does in his life. Amen. And one of the things is God doesn't do wickedly. He didn't throw a rock and hit you in the head. Somebody else may have done it, but God didn't do it. Amen. Hello. God doesn't do wickedly. And so we find ourselves, amen, often, amen, in situations where we think we're out of the will of God, and in reality we're not. Many, many times I've known people to come down to not having much food in their pantry, And so they go to their pantry and they begin to dig out the stuff. And lo and behold, they find that there's enough stuff in the pantry to fix dinner for that night. Can I get a witness? Amen. And so they make things. Amen. They may even make it up. At home, my wife likes to watch all these cooking shows. Amen. And they mix all kinds of food in. Amen. And you're supposed to make a meal out of it. Well, I've actually seen it at home. Amen. Where my wife or someone else, amen, went to the cupboard and this is what we have. And they put it in the blender. Can I get a witness? Mix it up and put it on a tray and stuck it in the oven. And that's what we had. Some people, some of the ladies I know have made up names for the food that they make. Can I get a witness? Amen. It's some kind of souffle or whatever. Tuna surprise. Can I get a witness? Amen. Whatever they have, find that they have enough stuff in the pantry to make dinner. Amen. And they can thank God for his great mercy. Amen. What does God plan for your life? What does God want you to do? And someone asked me that this week because their life was changed. And I realized that if nothing else, as my physical condition, as I get older, I can't do the physical things I once did. It doesn't change the fact that I can still witness to somebody. I can still pray for them. I could still do things, amen, even if physically I can't do it anymore. Somebody asked me to lift 200 pounds, I'll go get Matthew. Can I get a witness? Hey, get on over here. I'm not going to lift it, but I know somebody can. Come on over here. Amen. So I have this desire, amen, to be happy. Hello. Have this desire to have joy. And often the devil works overtime to try to tell me what I'm doing isn't the will of God. And if I listen to that, I get discouraged. What you're doing, you're wasting your time. You're not doing what God really wants you to do. If you listen to that, you'll get upset. But if you listen to the Word of God, you realize that God has placed you exactly where He wants you. And you can rejoice and be glad that God is using you right where you are. He's using you to help people that He wants you to help. And even though you had a different plan, doesn't make a difference. Amen. God is working in your life, doing a good thing for somebody. Hello. It's not always, but even in my own neighborhood, sometimes I'll come outside in the driveway. I have a little work to do in the front yard or something, and one of my neighbors will come over and start asking me questions. I didn't invite them. I didn't say anything to them. And I have things to do, but they start asking me questions. I'm not going to tell them to go home because I got to finish my work. So I begin to answer their questions, begin to do things, amen, that will help them, amen. Many people, amen, even this week I've heard people say, I wanted to be at a certain place, but I can't be there because I have these other issues that have come up. It doesn't make it wrong. It just says God had a different plan for me. If I always go by the plan that I select for the day, I'd be out of the will of God all the time because I would select something fun to do. Can I get a witness? I'd select something that I like doing, and I might not involve people even, just something I like doing, and I go do it. Well, nobody's going to stop me, right? Amen. But that doesn't mean that's what God has for me. Amen. I love praying in the Spirit. I love praying, and I hear people all the time tell me, God woke me up at night. God got me up early in the morning and urge me to pray. And you don't know what you're praying about. You don't know who you're praying for. You just know God got you up and you're praying for somebody. And you might not ever know until you get to heaven, but one of these days somebody is going to come up to you and say to you, thank you. You got up on Thursday at 4:00 in the morning and you prayed for me and I almost got in an accident, but I didn't. And I know absolutely it's because you prayed and God spared my life. Hello. Amen. We're not going to know until we get to heaven. Amen. I shared the other night, and I've shared it many times, there are more than 20,000 different Christian organizations in America. It's startling to me because there's only one Savior. There's only one Jesus. As far as I know, you know any more Jesus? I only know one of them, amen? Only one real one. One Savior, one Lord. And often there are all these other organizations, amen, out there. And someday, God is going to have to put His church together, amen, and make it work together as one, because He said He was going to do it. And when God says He's going to do something, He's going to do it. So that means He's going to send somebody from some other place over to you, and you're supposed to treat them nice and not chew them up and kick them off your porch. I'm preaching to me tonight. I've had Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and I don't know who all come and show up at my doorstep. I know Pentecostal people that threw them off the porch, bodily, kicked them off the porch. Hello. They asked me, where do you go to church? I said, I'm Pentecostal, and they jumped back. Amen. They're afraid I'm going to do something. Hello. And I got to talking, a group of Mormons came to my house one day. And I'm telling you, a lot of stuff they believe is just not in line with the Word of God. So I began to witness to them and talk to them and tell them exactly what the Bible says. And when they left my house, they left scratching their heads. Because I read them out of the Bible what the Bible says. They told me what they believed, and I showed them that this is contradictory to what they believe. Hello. And they left scratching their head. I didn't kick them. I didn't knock them off the porch. But I fed them the Word of God. And I'm telling you, I believe with all of my heart, at least one or more of those people got saved. When I get done with them, amen, I leave people, I mean it, they leave me scratching their head. Doesn't mean what they learned was right, but when I read it right out of the Bible, it affects them in the fact that God wants to save them. He wants to save everybody, but it doesn't mean that I like doing that kind of thing. If somebody, amen, if I see people coming with their tracts and paraphernalia and I don't want to talk to them, I just close the door and go in my room and turn the TV up real loud, amen. Hello. I won't talk to these people. You might have a chance to be talking to the next great evangelist, some great preacher somewhere someday, even though they belong to some crazy organization. We had an ex-Mormon come in here and tell us all about it, but he got saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and serving God, doing it tonight. Wonderful, wonderful man. He got delivered, amen. Y'all not listen to me, but it's all right. I've had to change a lot of stuff in my diet. And many times I'll go home and have dinner and I won't like not one bite that I'm eating. I wish I could get a witness. There's no salt in it, no flavor. I just as well roll up, amen, a piece of paper and eat it. I'm preaching to me. I got to smile while I'm eating it because it's good for me. I'm not supposed to eat the salt. I'm not supposed to have cholesterol. I'm not supposed to have all this stuff. And I sit down and have a meal. It's not my favorite meal, but I got to eat it because if I want my blood pressure to stay down, I got to eat good food. If I don't want my cholesterol to squirt up a here somewhere and affect my heart, I've got to eat things that have very little cholesterol in it. Amen. I found out by looking in packages, amen, that I can't eat certain things. Do you know that frozen dinners are 43% cholesterol? Hello? Take a look at the package. Turn the package around. It'll scare you sometime. Amen. I've seen cookies, 333 calories for one cookie. I'm supposed to have 2,000 calories a day. I could eat six cookies. That's it for the day. I wouldn't have believed you could get 333 calories in a cookie. Amen. I'd say that. It's impossible. 100% sugar, 100% cream, 100% butter. They're in there. They stuffed them in there. Amen. And I like this in Romans. And just stick with me a little bit here. Praying in the Spirit does a couple things. It does, number one, gets the will of God for you. But also you have to realize that praying in tongues came from God. He has given you a solution to your problem. He has given you something you can do at home, in church, or wherever that brings the will of God to your house. If you will do it, nobody is going to make you do it. Nobody's going to come on your porch, knock on your door, and grab you up by the hair of the head and make you pray in tongues. You got to do it because you want to. If you'll do it, and you begin to pray, the will of God will show up at your house. But it won't necessarily come in the form of a new car or a new house or something material. It may come in the form of somebody knocking on your door that needs a ride somewhere, that needs some food, or needs an answer according to the Bible. Are you listening to me? The will of God can be a wonderful thing if you'll just start yielding to the Spirit of God. I'm amazed when I go places how many people track me down and ask me questions. I can go to a yard sale and somebody will come up to me and tell me about their back problem. And I thought, do I look like a preacher? I don't have preacher on my shirt or pastor, whoever. But they'll come up to me and ask me, what about this? Do you know anything about the Bible? I say, well, I know a little bit. Go ahead on. I don't understand how God knows it, but he doesn't just put me somewhere. He puts me somewhere and sends somebody where I'm at. Are you following me? I don't just do things. It seems like that's the case, but it's really the will of God sneaking up on me. And I go somewhere and here comes these people and I get a chance to witness to them and talk to them and minister to them and pray for them. Hallelujah. I'm preaching to me tonight. On the internet, and or you could do it on your TV as well. If you want to watch a program, you just change the station. Hello? If you want to listen to something, if you really need to hear something, you can get on there. If you're on the internet, you can change the website, and you can get where you need to be. If you wanted to order a pair of shoes, you can get on a website, and you can order a pair of shoes. You can hear Jonathan Edwards preach his great sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. You can look on there and find directions on how to get from where you are to where you need to be. Hello. If you want to, you can get on there and it'll show you how to plant your flowers or fix your car or do any number of things. It allows you, amen, information that you don't normally have. And when you begin to pray, the same type of thing begins to happen. Is that the Bible says God takes your prayer, he intercedes in your prayer, and he takes it to the Father, and the Father sends back an answer to you. And so now you have a great high priest, his name is Jesus, and he's interceding for you when you pray. And so he's sending you the answer. Hello? He's sending you the answer. Hallelujah. I love this passage. And I've learned a lot when I went to the Bible school about praying. And praying brings significant change to my life, but it doesn't always line up with what I want to do. It doesn't do the things that people say that God does. Amen. I've heard people say you're supposed to have a lot of money. I've never had a lot of money, ever. But I've sure been in the will of God many times. I'm telling you, whenever I go do a funeral service, the anointing God will come upon me, and I can tell you of a surety I cannot feel any more in the will of God than when I go help another family who lost a loved one. I cannot tell you how many marriages I've done, weddings I've done. I have done a lot recently, but I used to do a lot. And when the couple have come up before me, many of them have gone into tears as they made their commitment to one another. I know I was supposed to be there. I know I was supposed to instruct them. I know that God brought me there. Amen. I could have been wanting, amen, usually it's on Saturday, and undoubtedly I would have liked to have been in front of my TV watching college football. Hello? Y'all don't do that. You like to be at the mall. Can I get a witness or doing something else at the park or somewhere? Hello? I'm preaching to me tonight. But it brings me to the fact that God knows what I need to do. And instead of being upset about it, I just need to worship and praise the Lord and give God glory. I'm going to share a couple more things and then we'll pray. I shared this the other night, I'll tell you, I'm going to share a different one then tonight. Many, many years ago, we were actually living in the condo in Upland. And we had a financial need in the church. And I was sound asleep in my bed. And at 4 o'clock inside here, I heard a knock on my front door. And when I woke up, I looked at the clock, and it said 4 o'clock, and I can't tell you how I knew there was nobody at my front door. And I understood God wanted me to get up and pray. This was a Thursday morning, early, 4 o'clock. And so I told the Lord, I do not know why I do these things. I got the message, and I'm getting up now, and I'm going to pray. It's 4 o'clock. I'm going to pray. But I'm setting my alarm tomorrow and Friday and Saturday and Sunday, and I'm going to get up for the next 4 days and pray. 4 o'clock in the morning. And I did that 4 days in a row. And I'll tell you, by Sunday night, every dime that we needed came into this church. Hello? Praying in the Spirit brings the will of God. I don't know how it got here, but it did. Often God does things like that for me. He told me to come here and he didn't tell me to leave. And whenever I just do what he tells me to do, he shows up and meets the need. And I know a lot of people, amen, that say that doesn't happen for me. And the only thing I could tell you, make sure you're in the will of God. Make sure you're doing what God called you to do, because you could be out of the will of God. There's some people I know that have absolutely no blessing of God in their life at all. If they needed 50 cents, they couldn't get it. Can I get a witness? If they need anything, they never get it because there's no blessing on their life. They're not doing what God called them to do. They pray. If they do, it's usually very little, and nothing happens because they're not obeying the Lord. And it's obvious for me when someone's always asking and never receiving unless somebody else gives it to them. No, when they never tell me, I was sitting at home and somebody drove by and came to my house and gave me money. The only way they get it is they con people and promise them the moon and go after and do whatever. It's a con game, and that's how they get their money. And if you would go in your prayer closet, can I get a witness? And pray and believe and trust God, somebody will come and help you out. Or you'll get overtime or something else will happen and the money will come to you so you can pay your bill. Hallelujah. I'm preaching to me tonight. Amen. I had a job once. They never gave overtime. Monday through Friday, 40 hours a week, nobody that I know ever got overtime. I needed some money for a bill, and somebody left the job, and usually they bring a temp in. They said, we're not going to bring a temp in. You're going to work overtime. And so I worked overtime, and do you know I worked just enough overtime to pay that bill, and overtime quit. I'm preaching to me tonight. I never got another overtime anything. Can I get a witness? Never while I was on that job. But because I had a need, I got the overtime. Amen. I love to pray in the Spirit, and I love to do what God's called me to do. And I'll tell you this, and we're going to pray. When you do the will of God, there's no feeling like it in the world that can match it. When you start to do something and the anointing comes upon you, and no matter what simple task God asks you to do, doesn't matter, simple or great, doesn't make a difference. There's just something that nothing in the world can satisfy like that Spirit touching you, saying you're doing what you're supposed to do for God. I've had it happen many, many times where the Spirit of God has come, and the anointing has come, and I've been able to help somebody. There's nothing like it on the planet. No amount of money, no amount of anything else can give you that satisfied feeling that you're doing what God put you on the earth for. And when you get that feeling, you don't want to ever lose it. You always want to get it. You always want to do what God called you to do. Romans 8 says, when you pray in the Spirit, you will get the mind and will of God for your life. You may not get to go to your favorite place. Hello? You may have to go somewhere where the people are honoring. You may have to go do something you don't want to do. But you get a chance to share the love of God, and you become a vessel. Hello? And when you get done, I'm telling you, there's nothing like it where you know you did what God called you to do. Amen. I shared this, but it's really funny. I have a dog, too. I got two dogs, Abby and Bingo. And Abby, for whatever reason, likes to jump up on the bed and lick my face and wake me up, usually about 4 o'clock in the morning. She doesn't do it every morning, but I know when she does it, it's time to get up to pray. Sometimes she has to get up to go potty, and I'll help her with that. But often, it's waking me up, and as soon as I wake up, I have that, you need to pray. You got that, I got to pray. And I don't smack my dog in the head and kick her off the bed and tell the Lord I'll wake up about 12. No, I'll get up and let's pray. Let's do what God put us on the earth for. Amen. We'll close with this. I said the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that's going to be revealed. How many people have we prayed for, this church has prayed for this year, that have had surgery, that have been sick in their body, that have had other procedures done, and now they're all beginning to come out of their dilemmas? It's amazing to me because a church this small, we usually don't have that many people that battles these circumstances. And now we see them come out. We see them, they're getting better. Even today as we sat with Lori up at the hospital, while we sat there, the doctor was fixing what was wrong with her. Oh, y'all not listen to me. It's nice to have somebody there. And she knew we were in the waiting room. It's nice to have somebody there to pray for you and also just be there. It's nice. Amen. There's times I've gone with people and their problem is so great, there really isn't anything that I can say, but I can go sit with them and let them know that I love them and that God will help them some way, somehow. But sometimes you don't even know what to say, but you just sit with them and they want something, you help them. But we're here for other people. Amen. I want to have that always in my life. I want to have that anointing that says yes to the Lord. And then be content where I'm at. When church is over tonight, I'm going to go get in my 2010 Toyota pickup. Hello. Four-cylinder. Can I get a witness? It won't do 100 miles an hour, but it does get me from point A to point B. It's got no exhaust on it except the regular. It's all standard. Everything's standard. Oh, y'all not listening to me? It's just fine. I don't need anything else. It's just fine. When I go home to eat, I do not have steaks and lobster and all kinds of stuff in my freezer. I got buttig ham. Can I get a witness? Amen. Or chicken or turkey or whatever's in there. And we have bread, and we're going to have a sandwich when I get home. Not a steak dinner. Can I get a witness? Not something else. Amen. But I'm going to pray over it. Thank you, Jesus. And eat it, and it's a great dinner. Hello. And my dogs will probably get at least a bite of it. Can I get a witness? Amen. Amen. We're going to do this tonight. Amen. We're going to do this tonight. Well, go ahead. What do you want to say? Amen. What we find when we pray is that God points us there. God points us there, and that's what we got to do is obey the Lord and see God do great things. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads tonight, if you would, and we're going to pray. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus for this wonderful opportunity. We thank you for your word and your spirit. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, you have taken some very difficult situations in our church, and you have turned them around. You said here in your word that all things work together for good. And, Lord, we are so thankful that you've done it. We can't do it, but you can. God, help us to continue to do the work of the ministry, that people that need help, even if they're a little ornery, that we'll go and help them anyway. We'll pray for them anyway. We'll assist them the best we know how. And God, we're looking for a great answer from you, that you will touch them and bless them and minister to their need. And Lord, we give you all the glory and the praise and honor tonight. And you said if we would pray in the Spirit, we would get your mind and your will and your desires. It may not line up with what we want, but we're going to help somebody. Somebody's going to get some help. Somebody's going to get healed. Somebody's going to get delivered. Somebody is going to receive a blessing because we're going to obey what you ask us to do. And Lord, tonight we give you the glory, the praise, and the honor. And we ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Anyone tonight need prayer? Would you come at this time? And we'll take a minute and pray with you. Anyone at all, we will pray with you tonight. Anybody at all. Praise the Lord. Would you stand with me, please? We're going to dismiss in a word of prayer. Did you get anything out of this tonight? Say amen. Let's remember the services coming up this weekend. Thank the Lord for his goodness. And let's just let the Lord keep having his way at Rock of Faith. Sister Mary Lee, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please. Amen. God bless you tonight. Amen. If you would, greet someone and tell them you're glad they came. God bless you.
Thank you for watching Rock of Faith. If you liked our service, please like and subscribe to our channel. If you really like our service, share it with a friend or family member. For the latest news and announcements, please go to our website, roffont.com. Our Google Calendar is on the front page. You can find the link in our video description.